why we need them, a bit about how they work, very high level. So let's just go over them. This is it. This is everybody. That's actually from I think almost 2 years ago now. So it's probably like 4 times bigger at this point. So one of the things I want to talk about is why so many tools, why it's so complicated, and what do we do about it. So let's start with the basic question. What is big data, right? That's a term that you hear a lot, but let's try to kind of define it a bit. So actually it's just the same as data, nothing fancy, just you have much, much more. But when we say much more, we have to be a bit more specific that we're talking about ingesting, storing, processing, and analyzing large amounts of data, right? Because you can take sharded MySQL and put a lot of data in it, like as much as you want, right? And you can get to big data also before like terabytes and terabytes. But to be able to take a huge set of data and be able to not only store it, but also process it, right? And have one process that looks at all this big amount of data and comes out with some kind of output, that's a bigger task than just what we usually do with simpler or more classical technology. So why is that not working with, why do we need big data tools, right? Why do we need to do something different? So let's say we have some data coming in. Let's talk about how we used to work before we had big data, and then how everything worked fine, and then what happened when we introduced big data into the play. Right, so in the normal case, we have some data coming in, we just put it in some kind of a MySQL store, right? And then, or something, or SQL Server, or Postgres, or whatever you want to use. Then at some point, let's say some kind of a data scientist comes in, wants to analyze the data, right? So what do? They query the data into their own laptop, machine, whatever, right? And then they use some local processing to look, to do their work, maybe R, maybe some other guy can come with MATLAB, right? And do the processing and get the result, and then this can continue forever and ever and no problem, right? Now, the problem is what happens when we try to apply the same schema on big data, right? So now instead of having some data coming in, we have a lot of data, right? And then we're trying to push it into the same MySQL server, and it goes up in flame, right? It cannot really stand the input rate that we are trying to push. It's locking tables, we get all these kind of memory pressure issues, things that you never learned about, now you find out they exist. So, but let's say somehow by some miracle you manage to put it into the database, right? So again, data scientist comes in, wants to query the data, wants to analyze it. So he's trying the same approach, pulling the data into the laptop, but now it actually cannot do it because the network is too much, right? Like you're trying to push a terabyte of data, just waiting for the terabyte to move into your machine, or 100 terabyte can take forever, right? If you have your connection here, the server is running somewhere, some data center, it's not gonna work. But let's say that by some miracle, you actually managed to get the data into your laptop. Now you're trying to process it locally, and you break your laptop, right? So now the process itself cannot load the data into memory, because that's how it used to work, by loading everything into memory, and so forth and so forth. So the point is that we have a very frustrated data scientist, and it's not just breaking in one point, right? It's breaking everywhere. It's not like we can get a better database and it will get solved, or get a better laptop for the people, or get a better network. Like this is not working in every step of the way. So we need to change the whole approach. And this is where we have the cluster. Okay, so a cluster, the definition here from Wikipedia, a set of loosely tightly connected computers that work together. So in many respects, they can be viewed as a single system, right? So now we're trying to move ourselves from an approach of this server does this to this server does that. We have a cluster, and the cluster does everything. So we change the rules of the game a bit, right? Instead of taking the data out because we had network issues and we had the problem that the laptops are not very strong, we don't ever do that. We just put data into the cluster. We never pull it out, actually. Because the data is only in the cluster, it never gets pulled out, then all the processing has to happen where the data is. So instead of getting the data to the laptop and doing the processing on the laptop, we actually take our processing and move it to where the data is, right? This is what we usually call data locality. If we are out of capacity, right, we have too much data, we had 5 petabytes, now we have 10 petabytes, we just increase the cluster, right? It's horizontally scale, means you can add more machines, just you have more power, you have more storage. And then one thing that we need to start thinking about is what we call resiliency. This is sometimes missed, but this is actually a huge point in all these cluster and big data technologies, is that you have to be much more vigilant about your resiliency, right? And when I have a SQL server or something, nobody talks about resiliency, right? Why not? Because if I have one server, it's gonna die every 2-3 years, okay? Maybe if it's, I have some luck, 4 years, 5 years, right? So, okay, once every few years, I have an incident, maybe I put HA on one server, another server, it's fine. The queries that I had will fail, it's not a big deal, right? Nobody asks, oh, what if I do a query to a SQL server, in the middle of the query, the server dies, how do I continue that query? They say, no, you fall back to another server, you restart your query, right? But here, when you have a cluster, you might have thousands of machines, okay? So now something that happened once every 3 years, now is actually happening to you every day, okay? If you run a big job and that job needs 1,000 machines and it takes, let's say, a day to run, you will never succeed to finish this job. Every day, at least one of those machines will fail and then the job fails, okay? So the key is that resiliency comes as kind of a side effect, a requirement of having big data, having the big cluster technology. So that always needs to be considered, and it's actually not that easy to achieve. So that sounds great, right? We put the cluster on and all the problems that I just spoke about, they go away, everything is fine, right? Only problem is this doesn't exist. Okay, so a few tens of years ago, maybe around 2000, most technologies in a very, very strict way were just single server. There were not much cluster technologies, but let alone like very, you know, useful for companies and so forth, maybe, you know, governments and stuff, this system. So actually we got to the point where we actually need to redo everything, okay? And when you cluster, you have to cluster everything. So that's quite a lot of work that we need to restart doing. When we have databases that have been worked on for decades, now we have to start rethinking the whole thing. So this is where the open source community really stepped up to the plate and was very excited about getting into this effort. And what's interesting when you saw how this was solved and how it's still being solved is, it's very much layer by layer. Okay, and this is maybe interesting in this concept of today's open source kind of discussion, is how open source has a very different approach to software than how usually enterprise, company generated software is, where you buy something from a big company, then they tend to give you all included, right? You get one product that does everything for you. You have it, and then you don't need anything else, right? In open source, it's quite the opposite. They like to do this, do one thing and do it well, which is kind of the Unix philosophy, if you read about that thing. So it means that every piece tries to do exactly solve one problem, okay? So when you look at this specific big data issue, basically what happened, it started to take the layers of what you need to have like a big data workflow, and layer by layer create technologies that supply that feature. So for example, if we start with storage, right? Talk about resilient distributed storage, what do we need? We need to be able to have some way to store huge files, right? Terabytes of files where the data itself is not in a single file system on a single disk. The file itself needs to be distributed across machines, right? And that started with HDFS around 15 years ago, and then later on continued with other technologies. Also S3 is a kind of that storage. And one of the interesting things that are rather new in this area is Alluxio, which is kind of a technology that is creating this kind of storage, but it's on memory. Okay, I will say a few trends that we have today. One of them is the move to memory, because memory is becoming not that expensive as it used to be. And now you can actually have your storage as a memory. And that's one of the things that we have. So let's say we got storage working, now we have the files, sitting there, and we can access them, and it's resilient, meaning there's replication and so forth. The next step that we need is scheduling, right? So if you're using Windows, then you have the task manager, and you can see all the processes running, right? And the same thing, you have a scheduler for Linux. This is the thing that says, you want to run this process, I'm going to get you some CPU time, I'm going to get you some memory, I'm going to allocate them to you, and you can use them, right? You have to go through this thing. Now, again, when you go to the cluster, there is no single CPU pool or memory. Now it has to be across machine. So I have to tell you, okay, I'm going to give you five different processes. This one you're going to run on this machine, this one you're going to run on this machine, and you're getting, I'm giving you 100 gigabytes of memory here, and 100 gigabytes of memory there. So that's, again, we have to rewrite that scheduler. And that's where we have things like YARN, which is mostly for big data and Hadoop kind of stuff, but you might have also heard about Kubernetes and Mesos that are actually used much more than just the big data kind of area. Okay, so now we can have storage and we can allocate processes. Basically, we're done. Like without this thing, we can already write applications. We have where to keep the storage, we have how to make them get CPU time, so I can go, right? I can go in the same sense that if I ask you now to write a website, you would do it in C, right? You probably would not choose C to do a website, because today we have much more high-level frameworks that take all the things that already been done and do it for us, what we call frameworks, right? Like .NET or Java and stuff like that, and they just abstract the really nitty-bitty connectivity to the storage and to the processor and all that stuff for us. So we also have this approach in big data, all right? So these, for example, are technologies that are about how you write your applications on top of them, just the same as you do it on top of Java or on top of .NET. One of the most famous one here is Spark. I don't know if you heard about it, but it's extremely successful project. I might say that it's really what brought on this big data craziness. It started in 2009 and kind of opened up and said, you know, outside of the MapReduce, we have so many things, other things we can do, and started this big fight of who has the best framework and so forth. So very, very nice software, very, very fun to work with. I highly recommend it. We use it a lot at Agoda as well. And basically, again, it's a framework. When you use it to write a distributed application, it becomes much easier for you because a lot of the hard stuff is already managed. So now we have a framework, we can write applications. So another thing to mention here is Flink, which is much newer than Spark. And it's kind of the reason I'm mentioning it is because it's kind of related to the trend of streaming that I will mention a little later. But that's also one thing to look out for. So now we have the ability to write applications, right? But even today, if I tell you to write a website, so you say, okay, I'm going to do it in .NET. I'm going to do it in Java, .NET, maybe not as much. But in Java, you're going to use a lot of external libraries, right? You want to use, if you use Scala, you might use Akka HTTP or Akka et al. or Play, right? So you're not going to do it from scratch just because you have a nice language and a nice framework. You're going to use something on top of it. Same thing goes with big data for machine learning, where we have now very, very good libraries that really help us and really like capture a lot of the important algorithms and the most successful algorithms. And the big companies being mostly Google does a lot of that, number one pusher of all these technologies, and also some stuff we have from Facebook and Netflix and other companies that basically help us build machine learning enabled applications without really implementing all the algorithms and stuff like that ourselves. Worth noting is TensorFlow, which is a very good library. It also has the ability to work with GPUs, which is another interesting trend that we are getting into in the last couple of years, basically using the GPU's special computation power to get algorithms running sometimes 100 and 1,000 times faster. Another one is ML System, SystemML, which is a nice library, which is worth mentioning because it's already an abstraction over the abstraction. Right, so this is a library of libraries. It's only made to make other libraries being even easier to use, right? So if you had a hard time using Spark, then SystemML will make it even more abstracted on top of it, which is kind of a sign of, I would say, maybe overgrowth, right, of libraries. When you have the so many things to do the same thing, then there's one thing that says, okay, now I will be the thing that allows you to use all the things, and so on, right? And it's a good sign of maturity, because you can think about other places where this has been happening. Like, look at the logging libraries, right? You have 100 of them, and then 10 of them just say that they do what the 100 do, and they do it together. So it shows that the area is coming to mature. And last step that we want some kind of already applications that we can just take and put in, and they just work, right? And one of the important things when you have data, obviously, is the database, right? So we can use a database that can work with distributed data. Again, our normal databases would not work here, because they don't know how to work against a distributed dataset. If you think about query planning and stuff like that, it's very different when you have to consider that, for example, what is the network bandwidth between different machines that you have to consider in your query plan itself. So some very good ones, and again, this is a very, very competitive field today. Just a few years ago, it was just hype, that's what you can do, which is a very slow approach with MapReduce that starts new processes on every query. And today, the fight is really, really strong. Presto coming from Facebook, which also created Hive to begin with, and it's very good, and also Cloudera's Impala is a very strong one, and more are coming every day, actually. So it's very much fun to watch them try to beat each other in benchmarks. By the way, they all win in their own benchmarks. That's also fun. So that's about that. Now, the one thing key to understand, if you're trying to get into this world, these layers have to be connected, okay? The database has to know to work with the storage and to know to allocate resources on the scheduler. And that's not always the case. Not everything works with everything, right? So this is just like an overlay of what works with what. Just from my memory, it's not a full a map of it. But that's just to show the complexity, right? So you can see, by the way, that one of the most connected ones is Spark, which is really the big advantage of it. That really it works with everything. It's built like that. It's not necessarily the fastest about all of these different tasks, but its ability to work in every possible scenario is one of the things that makes it so appealing. But definitely one big thing to consider is that those interconnectivity. Okay, so just a few words about trends we have today. So I kind of touched about streaming with Flink. Streaming is an idea that instead of the standard way of thinking, where I have some data coming in, first thing you want to do, you want to store it. And then you want to mutate it, no problem. You read it, you mutate it, you store it again, right? We call it ETL, very, very known concept. In streaming, we're trying to basically stay off the ground, okay? So as data comes in, possibly with something like Kafka, which is super successful and very, very good project, we can actually process it on the fly as it comes in, okay? So instead of getting the data set, storing, processing again into a new storage, processing again into a new storage, we can get the data, process it as a stream, process it into a new stream, and then process that into a new stream, and then at some point, storage or not storage, doesn't matter. We can actually have an application in the end that just acts as soon as possible. So at no point in this process, we actually stopped to aggregate it into the disk. We just went on the fly as we go. And today you can even talk about streaming machine learning. We have stuff like that, TensorFlow supports some of that. GPU processing is a big deal. GPUs, so they have a very different architecture than a normal CPU, and they can have thousands of cores, where a normal CPU would have few. So that can be a huge difference in how much processing power you have when you do the specific things that GPUs are good at, right? They're not as generic as a normal CPU. They do some of the very specific kind of operations that were originally made to make your first-person shooter to look much better, but now they actually used to give you a recommendation on the website, which is actually pretty great if you think about it, how this technology has been used. And actually today even Google are making their own thing they call TPU, which is a tensor power processor unit. So it's actually even more extreme in putting just firepower into one chip that is very specific to do very specific types of operations, which is mostly linear algebra. And I mentioned the in-memory. So memory today is not as it was used to call the gold of the of the virtual servers, and it's not that expensive today. You can get like a 1 tera, 2 terabyte memory machine, and obviously you can get a lot of them. And it's not that expensive as it used to be, that it starts to be cost effective to just like use it even as a storage layer, right? Obviously resiliency becomes much more critical because every restart you lose that part, right? But that actually gives you much more real-time impact. And the last thing, which is part of the machine learning, deep learning, which really made popular maybe 5 years ago, mostly by Google as far as I know, and huge impact on how smart our machine learning became. And it's a huge revolution that not necessarily well understood around the world yet, but like almost every big machine learning problem we had, starting with image recognition, voice recognition, translation, is just being transformed by this new ability. And it's very, very accessible, again, through something like TensorFlow, that there are really, really cool stories about how that can be used in, even, you know, not necessarily with data scientists with 5 PhDs can start using these things and get some really, really good results. So I urge you to look into that a bit. Now, the cool thing is that these trends are not disconnected from each other, right? So if you think about what I can do with all these things coming together, I can have data coming in where I process it and I do it all in memory because I have in-memory storage, and I do a deep learning algorithm streaming into my my cluster with GPU processing. I can be fast enough to react. So when the user comes into the website, I can have all of that happening in real time. While he's browsing the website, I actually update my models and can have a better experience for the user. So actually the future is quite interesting, quite exciting about what we are almost able to do, in some cases are able to do already. So what's the challenge for me, right? As a data architect. So as we saw, there's many tools and they change like that. Every day they tell you that there's something new, you should drop everything you did, throw it away, start with this thing, right? This is the hype, obviously, and that's fine. But the challenge is that, unlike some other cases, data is very costly to change. If now there's a new data format, right? I just read about one a few days ago, it's better than the one we're using. Now, to move all our data into another data format is a huge project, right? There's lots of it. So these kind of the big challenges we have today, just to cope with the rate of changes. Even though, personally, I feel that in a few years, this will converge. The windows will come up eventually, and it will not stay this kind of a crazy jungle for so long. But anyway, this is the world we live in and some of the challenges that we have. That's it. Thank you.